David with Gerald Fleury.
Greetings, everyone. Steve Jobs built what many consider the greatest corporation in the world, and it seems like nobody has ever equaled what he did in technology. There is a lesson that he learned in the process of his business that I think is still a mystery to many people. Certainly even businessmen have not learned the tremendous lesson that he learned that made him such a success. Now, he was obviously a very brilliant man, but there are a lot of brilliant people on this earth, and they haven't come close to what he did in his business. Why is that? Why was he, according to most authorities, the most successful man ever in the field of technology? Why was he so successful? How did he do it? Well, I want to show you the key to his success in technology today, and also show you that that key is really a tie to the ultimate success you can ever achieve. It is a powerful and a strong insight into building a successful relationship with God. And it is one that God emphasizes a great deal in the Bible. And that means you can be successful in every endeavor of your life if you practice that principle. And it can give you a lot more than just success in technology. It can give you success forever in a powerful way. Because if you look at the success he had in technology, it really is a key to the ultimate success in this life, and really it's a part of eternity, a part of forever. And I'd like to talk to you about that ultimate success today and use some of the lessons that Steve Jobs learned to teach us what we can do and what we can achieve in every area of our life. Steve Jobs said this: your thoughts construct patterns like scaffolding in your mind. You are really etching chemical patterns. In most cases, people get stuck in those patterns, just like grooves in a record, and they never get out of them. They just kind of get into those grooves and they never get out of the box, as he might say. And we have to make sure that that doesn't happen to us, but it does happen to most people in this world. It does happen that way. He created Apple Corporation, and then things went so badly after a while that he was fired from that corporation by the board. Then he really, in that second act, if we can call it that, it has been called that by an author I'll mention today. But in that second act, he learned a powerful lesson about how to be successful in technology and really in any other field if you follow what he taught and what he believed. So let's talk about the ultimate key to success today. And let me read to you a quote from Walter Isaacson, who wrote the biography of Steve Jobs. Here's what he said: the best thing ever to happen to Steve is when we fired him, told him to get lost, Arthur Rock later said. The theory shared by many is that the tough love made him wiser and more mature, but it's not that simple. At the company he founded after being ousted from Apple, Jobs was able to indulge all his instincts, both good and bad. He was unbound. The result was a series of spectacular products that were dazzling market flops. This was the true learning experience, what prepared him for the great success he would have in Act 3 was not his ouster from his Act 1 at Apple, but his brilliant failures in Act 2. See, he didn't have any restraints on him. And Act one was, well, he built the Apple Corporation. Act two, well, he was fired from Apple by the board. And that act two, he was actually on his own. And that's when he really learned some lessons the hard way. And then act three was when he then turned back to Apple, went back to Apple, and had the most spectacular business success ever, perhaps. Now, how could he do that? What did he do specifically? What trait did he have specifically that worked so powerfully in his life? Well, I want to get into that today and talk about, well, some of those brilliant failures, and most of all, though, about his just super success in technology and in this world. But anyhow, when he was with Apple, he was restrained by the board because it was a corporation, and he couldn't do what all he wanted to do. But when he went out on his own, he was just unrestrained and made all kinds of horrible mistakes. And he began to learn from those mistakes. He began to learn the hard way how to succeed in a technology corporation. I want to quote, give you a few quotes today from the book Becoming Steve Jobs, and by Brent Schlender and Rick Tetzeli. And maybe even this ties in with a few comments from the Fast Company magazine about that book. But here is a quote from the magazine. Brent, that is one of the authors, believed that Jobs had changed more than any other businessman he had covered. Well, he changed. And I you have to think about that a little more. Well, what change was it? What kind of a change did he make? I'd like to get a little more specific in that area. But here is what Lorene Powell Jobs, Steve Jobs' wife, she said, Steve was someone with a deep hunger for learning who breathed in an education wherever he could find it. She goes so far as to call him a learning machine. It was just a learning machine, she said. He learned from his many failures and relentlessly applied those lessons. Steve was always changing. But changing in what way? What specific way? Well, this book continues, a quote here, another quote from it. I look at Steve as someone who was actually always trying to change, said Catmull, or Ed Catmull, who knew and worked with Steve 25 years. It's not a matter of just design or simplicity or focus. He says it's a narrative of constant change. Well, what is that really? What is that trait then? What is that strength when you just constantly change like that to build a great work? What is it that we need to be concerned about? Well, in the period after he was fired, Steve Jobs purchased a small company called Pixar Today. And from those leaders, we're told that he learned a lot of lessons about managing. He didn't really know very much about that, and that's one of the big reasons he was fired, the first in Act 1, let's say, in Act into Act 2. But when he saw how effective these managers were at Pixar, then it was kind of an epiphany for him that he realized, well, hey, they just produce one success after another, after another, after another. How do they do that? And he was determined to learn that and take that into his next business, which happened to be back to Apple in Act 3, as it is called in the book. And he went back and made it the most successful corporation in the world, many believe. But he looked at Pixar and he saw, you've heard of the Pixar and the animated movies they create. They had the Toy Story trilogy. and the Bugs Life movie and the Incredibles and Finding Nemo and so on. And it just one after the other was an amazing success. He was determined to learn how they were doing it. Now it was so, they were so rigid in that he couldn't get in too involved because the system wouldn't allow it. But notice what it says here in this book. Watching our collaboration where we were making ourselves better by working together, I think that fueled Steve, says John Lasseter, the director of Toy Story and The Incredibles, who now heads up Disney Animation and Pixar with Catmull. That was one of the key changes when he went back to Apple. He was willing to be open to the talent of others, to be inspired by and challenged by that talent, and also and to inspire them to do amazing things he knew he couldn't do himself. Now that's quite a change. And it's just, he watched them and they just kept succeeding, and he wanted to duplicate that, and he did when he went back to Apple. Now, let me read you just a couple more comments here from the book. It says, each member of that team performed heroic work. Bill Gates said this about it, quote, that is really a crack team that bonded with each other in toughness. He's talking about Steve Jobs' team after he went back to Apple. And he says, I mean, you can point to every member of that team and say, okay, he earned his pay, he earned his pay, he earned his pay. There's no weakness in that team. No weakness in that team. Now, Steve Jobs went in there and he really changed his approach to managing a team. And he realized there had to be a team effort to make a great corporation. That it always is a team. And he changed himself and became very teachable. Teachable to the laws of technology and his business and his work. And he created what he called an A-team and taught them to have the same attitude, every single one of them. And if they didn't have that, they didn't last at Apple. That they all had to be teachable, not to their desires or not to political correctness or anything that would get in the way of their work. The work was first always. And Steve Jobs had the authority and the will to make it work. And they were producing products that people loved. So he said, look, in the way you structure this, and he didn't mean this the way you might take it, but he said you have to be ruthless to build that kind of a team. And he didn't mean, although he may have been a little ruthless at times, he didn't mean ruthless toward people, but in ruthless sticking to that, being teachable. Every member on that team had to be teachable. And I mean really teachable. If you can, let's say, set the example of being teachable like a child is teachable, when it comes to technology, now I'm just talking about technology, but it is a lesson that we can tie into our spiritual lives that will teach us really one of the great principles of God and maybe the greatest of all if you're going to succeed with God. I think it may very well be. So he taught the team and he said, now look, in the past he knew he hadn't been that way and he wanted to change and he was willing to always be teachable to that team, and he had strong personalities and strong men and women around him, and they challenged him, and he wanted it that way. He wanted to know if he was wrong, and if he was wrong, he would admit it. Now, it might not have been that easy always, but he certainly did a very good job of that. And as I said before, those that were not teachable, they didn't last. Now, he obviously had some serious character flaws. But he didn't have flaws when he was running the Apple Corporation. He became, in that Act 3, when he went back to Apple, a different person in that he was teachable and he would always give in to whatever came out that was obviously right. And it's like every man and woman around him was a leader, a powerful leader in that team. Now, the thing about it is this, if you want to look at this spiritually, he just kind of scratched the surface of the ultimate success. He was successful in technology, but that's just a little part, a little slice of this world and this life. Any business is. But what about the ultimate success? What the ultimate being, ultimate in being teachable? What about that? What's that about? Steve Jobs was certainly excited about technology and really almost gave his life to it. But God says there is a teachable attitude that we must have toward Him if we're going to achieve the ultimate success, not only for today, but forever. Now, He really means that, and it works. If you apply it, I guarantee you it'll work. It's an absolute guarantee that it will fill your life with joy and happiness and excitement. And it'll be far more than being successful in technology. But you will be successful in that part of your life as well. And it's a tremendous lesson to learn. There are many scriptures that tell us that God is the great teacher. And if we're ever going to really fulfill our potential, after all, we have proven to you in the Incredible Human Potential and other books that God is recreating Himself in man. I mean, you talk about being successful. Look at what God is doing in man and the mind of man that He's created and the body of man. And creating the whole universe. He wants us to be creators like He is. And be successful beyond anything you could ever even begin to imagine that is achieved on this earth. Now this is reality. God created man for a purpose. But too often we just get lost in a little business in this world, a little slice of life that really is nothing compared to what God wants to give us. It's just virtually nothing. Notice verse 5. I'll read it a little list to you. Well, it just says, in that day, I just wanted to show you that this prophecy is for this end time. In that day means for today. And then notice verse 7 and 8, but they also have erred through wine and through strong drink and are out of the way. The priest and the prophet have erred through strong drink. They are swallowed up of wine. They are out of the way through strong drink. They err in vision. They err in vision. Now, we have a booklet, Education with Vision, we want to send you, and all of our literature is free. But it'll tell you where they err in vision. And then they stumble in judgment, for all tables are full of vomit and filthiness, so that there is no place clean. God is talking here spiritually. So what is the solution to this? Well, God tells us right here in verse 9 at this time. He asks and answers the most important question in education. Notice this, quote, verse 9, whom shall he teach knowledge? Now, who is God going to teach knowledge? He wants to teach knowledge. He wants to teach us like Steve Jobs was taught, only far more and on a much higher level. Whom shall he teach knowledge? Well, now that's the biggest question you'll ever ask in education. And it should be asked It isn't in most all cases. And then it goes on to say, and whom shall he make to understand doctrine, or his Bible? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. Now, what does he mean by that? If you're going to be taught by God, you're going to have to be weaned from milk and from nursing like a little baby. You're going to have to be weaned from man, from looking to human beings. Cursed be the man that trusts in man, Jeremiah 17, verse 5. God says you've got to get beyond men. You've got to get beyond even Isaiah. He's just a man. You've got to get beyond looking to men, whether it's in a church or wherever. It doesn't matter. You cannot look to men. If you do, you will never be taught by God, not in any profound way. Never taught by God. And if you get to the point where you get men out of the way and you just let God teach you Himself, your life is going to soar spiritually and successfully and in every way. And that too is a promise throughout the Bible. That isn't something I'm telling you. That's what your Bible tells you. That's what God tells you. The ultimate success is to get past man and let God teach you, the great teacher, and be teachable before Him. That's what he's talking about here. And he says in Isaiah 66, verses 1 and 2, to this man will I look, that man who is of a contrite and humble spirit. God wants to teach. He's a teacher. And he wants to teach you how to be the ultimate success. That's what he wants to do, and that's what he will do if you will allow him to do that. So you have to get beyond men. This whole world is deceived, Revelation 12 and verse 9. But learn to let God teach you instead of a man. Now, you see, Steve Jobs, he got beyond the ideas of men in many ways to the laws of technology, the laws of the free market, the laws of his work, and the laws of success, and he wouldn't let any human desire or human idea get in the way. He really was a master at that. And it's a wonderful lesson to teach us about the ultimate success. And that is to be teachable before the great God, to let Him teach you. Steve Jobs learned that in a physical way, but not in a spiritual way. And he's always was willing to change when he saw that it wasn't right for the work, that it wasn't right for what he wanted to do. And what a big lesson that we can learn from that spiritually. Let me just read verse 12. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith he may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. Here God is trying to tell us how to not grow weary and not just kind of give up in life because of all the problems. You won't be that way if you let God teach you. It won't happen. And you'll be refreshed and uplifted and inspired. That's what this verse is all about. If you let God teach you, that's the kind of life that you will live. And you will be successful in every endeavor the way Steve Jobs was, only on the spiritual level. Now that is something that we really need to think about. I need to think about it more, and you do. We all do. Learn to be teachable before the greatest teacher there is in the universe. Your creator, your ruler, if you choose to let him be and guide you as your father because he loves you and his son died for you. That's how much God wants to teach us. He's given His Son to die for this earth so that He can teach us and help us to understand and become members of His own family and let Him recreate Himself in man. That is God's goal. Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.
Steve Jobs was perhaps the greatest inventor of his generation. The Apple CEO was brilliant and wildly successful. What was his secret? Steve Jobs learned the hard way that success is a team effort. He changed his character drastically and became teachable. His team took on the same trait. Jobs didn't know it, but he had unearthed the ultimate key to achieving success. Success comes from being teachable, and eternal success comes from becoming teachable before God. The good news is you can have this kind of success. To learn more about becoming successful by learning from God, request our free booklet, The 7 Laws of Success. The 7 Laws of Success by Herbert Armstrong is a powerful small booklet that you'll find easy to read and powerful in practice. Also request Education with Vision. Education with Vision reveals the fundamental aspect of education, an aspect that's missing in institutional education. To enhance your study on the laws of success, also request our 2 free reprints, The Most Important Question in Education and Steve Jobs and His Burning Passion to Be Perfect. You'll also be sent a free subscription to our news magazine, The Philadelphia Trumpet. Each month, The Trumpet looks at today's most relevant headlines and shows how they relate to Bible prophecy. Your subscription has already been paid for. Order your free booklets and reprints now.